Good morning, Austin. The proud folks there at Austin Community of Atheist Community of Austin are proud to present the Atheist Experience with today's featured guest, Don Rhoades. And filling in at co-host for Vic, we have, we have Martin Wagner filling in for Vic Farrow this week.
Which
and
is
on to our host with Jeff D. Take it away, Jeff.
Thanks, Ray. Hi, folks. Welcome to the Atheist Experience. This show is brought to you by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. We are live. It's February 13, year 2000. The Atheist Community of Austin has weekly meetings Sunday mornings at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop, 307 West 5th Street at 10:30 a.m. right after the show, except for the first Sunday of each month when we have our lecture series at 11 a.m. at First Cafeteria. Last week, our guest speaker at the lecture was Army Chaplain Bill Hughes, and we'll be talking about that a lot here.
I think we will, indeed, yes.
ACA board meetings take place at noon right after our regular meetings on the second Sunday of each month. These meetings are open to all ACA members, but you can only vote if you're on the board of directors. But this week's board meeting has been postponed till the 20th. For more information, you can call our voicemail at 371-2911 or visit our website at www.atheist-community.org. And we want to remind everyone once again that this show can be viewed on the internet. Set your browser to spring.net, and you can either just listen to the audio or you can click on a link that will bring up a real video player and watch streaming video.
And Vic, who is out of town, I'm filling in for, he's apparently in San Antonio, and says that either his brother or a relative or a cousin, friend of his, has online access down there, and so he told me he would be tuning into spring.net this morning.
Great, maybe
and
he
if
would
it's,
be kind enough to give us a call.
And he would be calling us if, in fact, we were up there. So
for those of you
we might hear from Vic
on
today.
The internet, in case you can't make out our number, which, you know, sometimes with that streaming video on the web, little
yeah,
details like that get
jerky,
lost.
Yeah.
The number is area code 512-472-2255. Anybody can call in, but if you call in long distance, make sure to tell the person who's answering the phone that you're long distance, and we'll get you on as fast as we can. Martin here is sitting in today for Vic, as he just said.
Hello, Austin.
Martin's been a guest on our show before.
Yeah, a couple weekends ago. It was a lot of fun.
And We try to make it a habit of talking about the interesting things about people who are on the show. Why don't you show that?
Oh, yeah. Amanda did this. Jeff's wife did this. I used to be, I was a comic book artist professionally for 10 years, and I had an alternative college-oriented comic book series called Hep Cats. And Amanda did this very nice sketch of some of my old characters from the old book.
It's very close to your style,
too. Yeah, very. And so I want to thank Amanda on the air for this. This was very sweet and very nice surprise. And I'll put this up on my wall of fame. You know, no longer in that line of work, but it's always nice to have these little reminders of where I started. And so thanks, Amanda, a whole lot. And so now I am hopefully moving my creative energies more towards film and video. I'm working on, I've done storyboards and character designs for a children's animated TV show, tentative show that a couple of friends of mine are developing through a company they founded. And I also did some conceptual artwork for the new film by Robert Rodriguez called Spy Kids, which starts
really?
Production on March 20th.
Cool.
Yeah, Robert and I drew cartoons together at the Texan back 10 years ago. So. And he never used to hang with the rest of the little cartooning clique. He would just sort of turn in, say hi to all of us, and he'd show up at about 6 p.m. and hand in his comic and, you know, and then go off. And so, of course, we had no idea that he was planning on, you know, what his ultimate goals were and what he was working on behind the scenes. But, you know, we're all real proud of him. And so that's nice. So that's where I'm now after 10 years of doing that, moving my talents in that direction. So hopefully things will pan out this year.
Cool.
But that's me. So
we appreciate you sitting in at the
it's my pleasure. Thanks for asking me. It was when I guested 2 weeks ago, you had some, you know, you were very nice things to say about the way I apparently I give a good accounting of myself. So hopefully I can keep doing that and not stumble and stutter and you know, break out into a flop sweat like that guy in broadcast news, you know. So, but this is fun, a fun show to be part of, and I'm proud of it.
It really is.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I also used to work in comics.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if there's something about that industry that turns out atheists. I don't know, but that's kind of interesting.
I used to read comics.
You used to read comics? There is definitely some kind of trend going on here.
Something, yeah, there's something about that.
You brought in some news.
Yes, I have this morning's news, which is ordinarily the co-host's job, right?
Yeah.
So,
And while he's doing that, can I get a volunteer to come up here and fill my mug with water? Because
yes.
I forgot to do it before the show today.
We don't really have...
behind the camera?
We're going to pretend we have, like we're a real TV show and we have interns.
I'll just set it, over here where you can grab it while Martin's on camera.
So, okay, so I guess...
You have to be on camera yourself.
Okay, so...
Can we get camera one?
Right.
Mm. Camera one, Ray?
I guess he's working on it.
Yeah.
Does the star have gophers now?
I'm getting complaints now from...
Okay, Ray's coming here and he's giving...
Out of the control room just to yell at me. This is not a regular thing. I don't plan on making a habit of this. I always get my own darn water.
I got my water before the show, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. See, it's right.
I got delayed.
All right. Anyway. Okay. Good morning, Austin, atheists and Christians alike. This is the news for Sunday, February 13th. Taking the commandments public. Indiana passes bill allowing display in schools, other government facilities. Indiana legislators approved a bill Monday, February 7th, that would allow schools, courts, and other public facilities to post the Ten Commandments. And nine other states are poised to vote on the contentious issue in coming weeks. The Indiana bill, which permits schools to post the Ten Commandments as part of a larger display of historical documents, passed the House 91-7. The state Senate has already passed a companion measure, and the governor has indicated he will sign the legislation into law. In South Dakota, and here comes the water, Waterboy has arrived. Adam Sandler has arrived
on the camera. That was awesome. Now you missed him.
Thanks, okay, but back
Thanks
to
Howard came out here with a little paper towel over his arm like a waiter.
Excuse me, but I'm giving the news here, and this is very serious.
Okay,
so please,
I'm sorry.
All right. In South Dakota, where the state Senate has passed a Ten Commandments bill, a similar measure may reach the House floor later this week after final committee hearing. The bills grew out of a movement sparked by conservative lawmakers, of course, across the nation following the shootings at Columbine High School in Colorado. Such violence occurs, proponents of the legislation argue, partly because schools have been so thoroughly secularized in recent decades. Posting the commandments, they say, would be a symbolic step back toward morality. Now, just to interject here, a couple of months ago when Ray was still hosting, you had a news item about yet another school shooter, and this happened to be a boy who was not a weirdo, who was not an outcast. He was, in fact, very popular, very gregarious, was like on the football team, and he was also known to be a regular, weekly, avid churchgoer.
Yep.
And he turns up at school one day and starts popping people. Okay, so he arguably was probably getting a fairly healthy dose of the Ten Commandments in his life, and it didn't seem to do him a whole lot of good. So clearly, this isn't really about, you know, I don't think, about cleaning up the morals of our society.
No,
this is
it's
just
about
this
it's about using the federal government to indoctrinate people. Children into a particular religion.
Yeah,
exactly.
It's about manufacturing little Christians. That's all it's about. Anyway, the article continues. Civil libertarians have protested the budding movement called Hang 10 on the grounds that...
Good grief.
Hang this, yeah. On the grounds that...
Is it really appropriate to use, like, surfer terminology to... to popularize your religious teachings?
Well, okay. You know, if you want to think in terms of wipeout, maybe. On the grounds that posting a religious document in a public space, especially in a school, violates the separation of church and state. Quote, the Ten Commandments have done pretty well for themselves for centuries. They don't need help from politicians, said Barry Lynn of Americans United for Separation of Church and State. More important, he said, is that the bills are patently unconstitutional. The pending bills attempt to circumvent a 1980 Supreme Court ruling that a Kentucky law requiring schools to post the Ten Commandments in public schools was unconstitutional because its purpose was, quote, plainly religious in nature. Indiana's solution is to permit the commandments, quote, as part of an exhibit displaying other documents of historical significance that formed and influenced the United States legal or governmental system. If a school posted the biblical admonitions along with the Magna Carta or the Declaration of Independence, it would not be subject to the Supreme Court ruling, the bill sponsors contend. And I would interject that Unlike the Ten Commandments, we actually have in our possession the original documents of the Magna Carta or the Declaration of Independence. No archaeologist that I know of has actually managed to dig up those stone tablets yet. So don't talk to me about the historicity of the Ten Commandments.
Can I just segue here for a second?
Oh, you may, yes.
If they did dig up the original document, assuming there ever was one, what would they find? Well, they would find a bunch of broken up bits. Because if you read the friggin' Bible, Moses comes down from the mountain. And he gets mad because the people are worshiping the golden calf. And he smashes the original set of Ten Commandments into pieces.
So how could anyone possibly
Nobody
know what they say?
Except Moses ever saw them, according to the and God. ever saw them, according to the Bible. More importantly, he goes back up to the mountain to get a new copy. Which, interestingly enough, according to the Bible, God did not write with his own finger, but Moses wrote down taking dictation from God. And the second set of Ten Commandments, the ones he actually managed to bring down from the mountain intact, the only ones he could ever prove to anyone were you know, what God wanted, because he broke the first ones, are completely different. The injunctions against homicide, theft, and perjury are completely missing from the second set of Ten Commandments, the ones which, according to the Bible, actually made it down from the mountain to be read by other people. What's in there are things like, thou shalt observe the feast of unleavened bread, 6 days shalt thou work. That's the seventh day. That's the same. Thou shalt observe the feast of weeks.
Whatever that
Thrice
means.
Thrice in the year shall all your men children appear before the Lord God.
And do
thou
what?
Thou shalt not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leaven. Neither shall the sacrifice of the feast of the Passover be left until the morning. The first of the first fruits of thy land thou shalt bring unto the house of the Lord thy God. And thou shalt not seethe a kid in its mother's milk. That's what's in there, in the second set. All of the moral rules that these guys think we need to have posted in schools, because without them, the kids will turn into little, you know, little gun-toting maniacs, aren't in the actual Ten Commandments, the ones which, if we had an historical document, this is what it would be.
And these are the only ones that are referred to in the Bible as the Ten Commandments.
That's correct.
Right.
The first
You're right.
set, the words the Ten Commandments never appear in connection with that first set. But in the second set, according to the Bible, God says, these are my Ten Commandments.
Right. Yeah. This is in, I believe it's Exodus 34, for those of you following along at home.
That's right.
Fascinating. But of course, it's all moot anyway, because it's a myth and Moses never existed. But anyway.
Let's be clear about the details.
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
I wish Barry Lynn would step up to the plate and say, hey, you morons, the things that you want posted as the Ten Commandments aren't the Ten Commandments, even according to the Bible they come from.
Yeah.
And they don't contain the kinds of moral guidance that you supposedly want to have taught in public schools.
But when did details ever matter to fundamentalists, Jeff? It's all about manufacturing little Christians. They could put a Cracker Jack box up there and call it the Ten Commandments if it got high school kids to turn into Christians.
Yeah.
You know, that's really what... But anyway, I won't read the whole thing in toto, but just to wrap up this particular news item, it just says that... let's see. Oh, here we go. Quote, we need to get what God has tried to teach, but I thought we just cleared that up. We need to get what God has tried to teach back in our hearts, whether you're a Christian or not, said Dan Swarthout, who helped organize a Kentucky rally. Listen to that quote and tremble. That's basically, if you're not a Christian, we are going to make you one. You will be one when we are done with you. That's right. What this is all about. Quote, it's a matter of right and wrong. No, it's a matter of tyranny versus freedom, and I prefer the latter, and they prefer the former. But civil libertarians point out that while some of the commandments are universal, you shall not kill, you shall not steal, yada yada, others are explicitly religious. Quote, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the house of bondage. Bob Stevens, Associate Director of the South Dakota Education Association, said that in testimony before a state Senate committee, proponents of the bill openly declared that they wanted to force a legal challenge, and that while school districts could not afford the legal cost of a lengthy appeal, the legislature could. They want a constitutional confrontation, Stevens said. And it wraps up to say that these are the states considering Ten Commandments legislation. And you can bet this list will increase as the election year goes on and as more pandering to the religious right goes on by both frontrunners, sadly enough. South Dakota, Colorado, Oklahoma, Mississippi, Missouri, Illinois, Indiana, which just passed theirs, Kentucky, Georgia, and Florida. And so if you think that it is melodramatic or paranoid to suggest that there is a serious move afoot to transform America from a free democracy into a Christian totalitarian police state, you need to buy some Vaseline and work your head out of whatever dark hole you're hiding it in. Okay? It is happening, and it is creepy. So, you know, atheists and freethinkers need to get active and get political. Like Howard Thompson with his non-theistic political caucus that he's starting up.
Which he's now backed away from.
Now backed away from? Well, that's kind of sad.
Lack of support.
Well,
which is a tragedy.
Hello, everyone. You know, that's a sad thing, a sad commentary on us. So we need, if you don't stand up for your freedoms, you will lose them. So that's that news piece. Now, how about onto some happy stuff before we go on?
Yeah, let's do your other one.
Yeah.
We've got some callers on the line. Please hang out.
Okay. Although, says ACA Mark.
What, am I to take that call right away?
Okay.
Mark Loewe, our member.
Oh, Mark.
Okay. Mark, just hang on the line for a minute.
Yeah, hang on, Mark. And
Let Martin finish his next story.
Yes, yeah. Well, I just have a couple more quick items and happy stuff to take away from the depression that I just read. Some science news. Interesting science news. Scientists recreate soup of primordial particles. This was from Thursday Statesman. Scientists in Geneva have recreated a primordial form of matter that physicists believe last existed in abundance when the universe was an exploding fireball only a fraction of a second old. The new material is a highly compressed gas of the particles called quarks and gluons. I love that name, gluon. The building blocks of ordinary particles, like the protons and neutrons within all the atoms in the universe today. The long-sought achievement might be compared to the first splitting of the atom to reveal its individual parts. The achievement will be announced today at CERN, the European Particle Physics Laboratory, where the work was carried out. The finding moves experimental physics closer than it has ever been to the presumed moment at which the universe came into being, and could help cosmologists better understand the driving forces behind the primordial explosion itself. The matter's existence confirms one of the most abstruse of all predictions by theoretical particle physicists. And that's something Mark will presumably really have something to talk about when he gets on there, if he wants to comment on this. Quarks and the gluons that powerfully bind them are normally joined to form protons and neutrons, and cannot be shaken loose individually no matter how hard pairs of the ordinary particles are smashed together. To create the new material, the scientists have, in effect, compressed and heated a ball of protons and neutrons so that they melted into their constituent quarks and gluons, which then floated freely in a laboratory for the first time. Quote, "It does indicate that a new state of matter is created," said Johanna Stekel, a physicist at the University of Heidelberg in Germany, who is the spokesman for one of the multinational collaborations that operate a large particle detector called NA45 at the Geneva Laboratory. "This new state, we think, the universe was in until about 10 microseconds after the Big Bang, and then crystallized into the particles as we know them now. A microsecond is a millionth of a second." Laboratory's experiment, said Michael Turner, a cosmologist at the University of Chicago, helps take us back to when the universe was a soup of the most fundamental particles we know. I thought that was very fascinating. And, you know, as science and discovery marches on, the reason to believe in fairies and elves and gods and monsters and supernatural reasons for things just dissipates.
I know. Do you have more besides that?
Just one more article,
Let's go ahead and post now so he can respond. To this.
And I'll do that later.
Hello, Mark?
Mark.
Good morning, Martin, Jeff, and Don.
How are you doing?
Pretty well.
We're getting some feedback over the studio mic again, right? Is there anything you can do about that? Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah. I had a question about, was it God who smashed the first Ten Commandments?
No, it was Moses that did it.
Moses who smashed them.
No, it was Charlton Heston who did it, but...
The question I have is whether, you know, if these legislators and fundamentalist education people want their children to act in a way that Moses acted, whether they would promote children to come in and smash whatever they post on the wall there.
well, I don't know.
Good question. We'll ask some questions if they call in.
Yes.
And Martin, I wanted to thank you for that that particle physics information.
Yeah, it's fascinating. Absolutely fascinating. And this is the sort of science that I think more people need to know about. And I was very proud of the Statesman for putting it in Section A. And, you know, somebody, there's a, must be a science editor there who is on the ball. And, you know, there is all sorts of discovery going on now. I'll definitely, you know, be bringing this to light, you know, whenever I'm doing this, and hopefully Jeff will be. We want to have more good, positive science news on the program as much as we can, so that we can actually serve, an, I think, an educational function on the show to, you know, be teaching people who don't know really how the universe works, how it works. And I think there might be an unfortunate perception that we're just here for an hour and a half on Sunday morning to poop on Christians, and that's not really what it's all about. We want to talk about positive atheism and science and discovery and knowledge, and really what, you know, the good things that those can give us, and, you know, not have it be, not have people get this idea that it's a very negative thing that we're doing.
Mark, can I ask you a question real quick?
Yeah.
I was hearing about this on the radio all day. I believe it was Saturday, and or Friday, I'm not sure. And it seems there's some controversy about the way this news was released. Are you familiar with that?
The news, the particle physics news?
Yes.
Actually, I haven't heard about the new experiment until Martin just mentioned it. And I've over the years, I've had some reservations, some skepticism about the existence of quarks and gluons. Because they haven't been able to be separated as separate particles. And so I'm very interested in the data that that they've gained from this new CERN experiment.
Well, go ahead.
Oh, okay, that's all.
Yeah.
Some of the comments were that that this wasn't really any, that they hadn't really done anything new. This was things that they had observed in the past. And instead of writing an article for a journal, they did a news release, which I guess is not very typical. And
they kind of broke etiquette, you think?
Well, some of the commentary was that this project in Switzerland is being shut down, and so they were trying to grab some last minute spotlight or something like that, or maybe keep the project going. I don't know.
Like everything else you hear. It might actually turn out not to be true.
Yeah, I mean,
so people need to keep their ears open and listen to what's being said, and figure out what the truth actually is.
As we, you know, have said many times before, science is an ongoing process.
And with those big particle physics experiments, there is some politics that enters.
Yeah.
Right. Sure. Well, I'm sure the amount of money that it would take to fund a project like this, there's just bound to be politics.
Right. And this. The search for quarks, wasn't that one of the big reasons why we pursued the now defunct superconducting supercollider project?
Well, partly that, and there's this other particle that has been predicted by Steven Weinberg and perhaps some others, called the Higgs particle.
Yes.
And I think that was one of the goals, was to discover the Higgs particle.
Hmm. All right. Well, thanks for calling.
Okay.
All right.
See you later, Mark.
That's
interesting. Yeah, it will be interesting to see how this pans out, if it does, in fact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's go to
Paul from Spring.net.
Paul?
Hey, how you doing?
Hi, Paul. What's up?
Hey, I want to apologize that we lost about the first 5 minutes of audio today because our main server went down.
Ah.
So we had to kick on our backup server. We didn't lose any video.
Okay.
So folks that tuned in at the beginning, they might have gotten a video with a hiss.
Okay.
But then now everything's working and
great,
it's
thanks.
Streaming out on the web.
Let me repeat that phone number for those of you watching on the web. This is pretty much live. and the phone number to call and talk on the show is area code 512-472-2255. I can't even read
that.
Yeah, Ray.
I'm sure
people on the internet can.
For some reason, Ray has it up on screen in baby blue with a white drop shadow
over
against
our
white. He's playing with it now. Okay, that's,
there we go.
I'd say darken it
colors.
Up a bit.
Oh, hey. All right, that's good.
No, it's still not legible. Oh. Anyway, thanks, Paul.
All right, and there is the conference, too. They can click in and post their comments on the web also.
Okay.
All right.
All right.
All right, thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Take care, Paul. Yeah, and anybody's out of town, out of Austin, watching on spring.net, you know, and if you feel like making a long distance call us.
Please let the call screener know that you're calling long distance.
Yes.
That number again is 512-472-2255. Of course, if you're local in Austin, you can just call right in and wait your turn.
Well, do your
last news.
Okay, my last news is just an amusing, lighthearted bit of entertainment news. Paul Verhoeven, the Dutch filmmaker who brought us such masterpieces as Showgirls and Basic Instinct, as well as RoboCop and Starship Troopers, apparently announced in the Netherlands. He spoke at a seminar organized by the Faculty of Theology at the University of Utrecht. And the theme of the seminar was, and I'm sure I'll pronounce this abominably, Jesus Christus niet te filmen, which loosely translates as Jesus Christ impossible to film. Although, an interesting little side note here, it says niet te filmen also means unbelievable. Anyway, Verhoeven revealed that his next project, after wrapping up his current film, the science fiction film The Hollow Man, will be the real-life story of Jesus Christ. Verhoeven clarified that a bit later on. He's not going to base the script directly on the scriptures of the New Testament, but on a historical reconstruction of the life of Jesus Christ. Now, immediately, I asked myself, what could possibly be his credentials for this? Reportedly, Verhoeven has a PhD in New Testament studies, which I wasn't aware of that, and I can see how he put that to good use in Showgirls. But also, he was supposedly a member of something in the 1980s called the Jesus Seminar, which I know nothing about, but maybe...
The Jesus Seminar where a bunch of liberal theologians got together and tried to pare down the New Testament to just the few things that they thought you could reliably... that they thought they could reliably claim Jesus actually said.
Okay.
And there wasn't much.
Well, Verhoeven seems to think he can get a film out of it. But he says, the guy who wrote this article said, what I gathered from his speech in the interview that followed is that this is not going to be a version that sets to please the Bible Belt. Supposedly we're going to get, Jesus fornicating all over the place and doing other un-Jesus-like things. Verhoeven also said the script is still being written as we speak, probably not be finished till another 6 months has passed. He still has to procure the $60 million necessary to shoot the film. I personally do not think that this thing will ever go before the cameras. I mean, his reputation is going to precede him, and if it's as outrageous as he claims it's going to be, I just think investors are going to flee from this. It could be done in Europe, but even if it gets done in Europe, I don't think he'll find an American distributor. Adrian Lin's Lolita was kicked around because everyone was terrified of it, and then it finally ended up premiering on Showtime.
Right.
And turned out to be incredibly tame and dull, but, they were afraid of this new potential child pornography legislation, and so that's just how anti things are. But speaking as an atheist and as also somebody who's becoming involved in film more and more, the whole idea of just making a movie to offend Christians, I think, is just kind of, especially, it's just sort of petty, it's a waste of time, it's kind of dumb. I mean, if you want to make a Jesus film, and make a historical Jesus film, I can see that you would do that, but to make something that I think you know in advance is going to be offensive and not care, it's not like, what's the point? There are better things to do, better ways to spend your time and your money than just to annoy Christians. Part of this article was comparing the potential fear that would arise from this to Last Temptation of Christ in 1988.
Right.
But of course, Last Temptation of Christ was a situation, of course, where the fundamentalists were completely misinterpreting the film. Last Temptation of Christ is probably one of the most devout films about Jesus ever made. Martin Scorsese is an extremely devout Catholic. And if you watch the film, it's about this profound spiritual triumph.
Right. It's not their version of Jesus.
It's just not, the same version that they get over and over and over again. So, but I just thought that it was a funny article. The idea of the guy who made Showgirls then going on to Jesus Christ just...
we got...
Life's little absurdities mount up.
We got Joe Zamecki on 4. Joe!
Hey! Good morning.
Hi, Joe!
Hi, Joe.
Are you watching this on the net?
Yes, I'm on there right now. I finally got it to work.
Cool.
Hot dog.
Looks great. Only awesome. A little bit delay. And y'all set looks really good, too. I can't recognize the guest, though. I haven't met him.
It's Don.
Don. Good to meet you. I'm Joe.
You haven't?
I used to
We've met. We've met, Joe. We've been on the show together. This is Don Rhoades.
No, the other side.
Martin, that's Martin Wagner.
I think I only met you once, and I was working camera one that day. You came in, you were just in town, I think, for the day, and we shook hands and said hi.
Yeah, and he is our guest co-host today.
Excellent. Okay. Yeah.
So, hi, nice to meet you
and
again.
And for those of you
telephonically
new to the show, Joe was the co-host of the Atheist Experience for 1 year, year and a half?
Yeah, just about a year.
Quite a while.
Yeah,
before I came on board.
Yeah. I don't know if y'all talked about this, but there is, in fact, this is kind of...
Can you talk a little louder, Joe?
Sure, I'm here. Okay.
Thanks. Okay.
I don't know if y'all talked about this much, but there is, the Messiah has returned.
Not again.
Yeah, he's in Pennsylvania this time.
Oh, yeah. Really?
In fact, he's in Hazleton, and he's actually traveling all over the country. And this is a report out of the Reading Eagle, out of Reading, Pennsylvania. He appeared from out of the blue one day back in October, clad only in a dirty white robe, as he walked barefoot along the winding two-lane highway into a struggling formal coal town of Lucerne County in near Hazleton, Pennsylvania. With hundreds of people gathering in fire halls, gymnasiums, and open fields to listen to the stranger, and by the way, yes, he looks just like Jesus.
Yeah, but so do you.
Right. The white version of Jesus, right? Kind of like me. People are coming by the hundreds to hear him talk, and they're listening to a stranger. His presence has some worried the community has opened its hearts, homes, and schools too readily to someone they know little about. But his supporters, fervent in their devotion, say they know all they need to know. The soft-spoken nomad is a messenger of God.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's a Roman Catholic, I won't say the name. She said, quote, "I would walk through fire for him." He's blessed by the Holy Spirit. People's hearts and are really changed after they've heard him. Now, "I would walk through fire for him" is kind of a strong statement there.
Yeah, well, I guess all I can say in response is that I'd like to congratulate this guy for coming up with a great con.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that he will clean up and be out of that town
before he's still wearing the dirty robes. That's what I want to know.
Now, he doesn't look very dirty in this picture, but...
Yeah, he will probably be gone one morning and no one will know where he went, and a lot of bank accounts might be cleaned out. Or who knows, maybe not. But any idea how this guy's doing in the polls against McCain?
Oh, right. I'm sure he'll do better, but... I don't know, and it goes on here, though he's preached for up to 6 hours at a stretch, he is a man of few words when it comes to himself. He will not divulge his birthplace or background because he says it would detract from his message.
And he doesn't...
those years in prison.
And the FBI would suddenly get a beat on him, yeah.
They know who he is, though. But
really?
Oddly enough, when somebody asks his name, he always comes back and he says, "Well, what's your name?" And the reason why is because he says it is part of a Hebrew tradition not to reveal one's name to a person until you become their friend, and it is what the locals now call him. "What's your name?" with a question mark. That's his name. Okay? But police checked his background and found nothing of concern from his past. He was arrested in Greenfield, Ohio in August after he refused to stop preaching to a crowd that became unruly when the police tried to break up the gathering. And he was identified in a police affidavit as Carl J. Joseph. And his 9-year trek has brought him to 47 states and 13 countries, though he says he never has remained in one place for so long before. And he goes on, he says, here is him talking, "People here have been wonderful," he said. "There's such a great need for spirituality today. People feel desolate because they have gotten away from God and his church. So what's the solution?" A new Messiah.
Yeah, more brainwashing, more, you know. It's 2,000 people.
Uh-huh.
You know, this is the age of science and discovery and knowledge. You know, go to school, get an education, learn about how the world works, learn to think critically, get out there and use your mind. It just reminds me of that scene in Life of Brian. I say you're the Messiah, I should know, I followed a few. I mean,
right.
You know, it just seems like, hey, oi, 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 oi.
Well, anyway, it's good to know that the Messiah is in our part of the country and not yours.
Yeah, so you guys are going to go check him out?
Well, I might, actually. He's kind of close by to me.
I think you ought to. You ought to.
What's interesting, though, is that wherever he goes, he's put up. People put him up, right, at churches and other places, and he doesn't have to pay, right? And I'm sure he's not having to pay taxes over this. But I'm sure he didn't make a lot of money because he, you know, whatever. He magnanimously gives it back to the public or whatever. But, I mean, if the guy just goes around talking, then that's it. And won't even...
And he doesn't get anything from these people in terms of money or donations or a place to live or...
No, it doesn't say anything about...
Well, he gets it. He is supposed to live. Georgia said they put him up. But it doesn't matter. Okay, so fine. So let's imagine for a moment he's not making any money on the side here. Who cares? He's still a kook.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's still, it's kind of scary.
Yeah.
The way
it's sad, I mean, what it is.
I'm more worried about the people that are actually lining up for this idiot.
It's sad and pathetic more than it's scary, really. It's just, you know, the indication of, you know, people's just... wild, you know, their willingness to throw themselves at any bizarre supernaturalism that they can find, you know, much more so than going out and becoming educated and knowledgeable about the world.
And when I hear something like this about somebody that's having this kind
atavism.
Of effect, the first thing I think of is I wonder when the mass suicides are going to start.
Yeah.
It seems to always follow from something like this. People do get hurt.
Yeah. Well, I didn't mean to be depressing or anything, but I don't have a joke, so...
No, that's all right.
Well, I mean, we need to know about these things, you know, I mean... Few rationalists that are left need to combat this.
Well, hey, you never know; it could be the real thing.
He's got the burden of proof.
Sure, I'd be happy to believe at the instant somebody can prove to me that it's true.
Now, we were talking earlier just before the show how if there really was a Jesus and he really did come back and was walking around, wouldn't he like really hate the sight of a cross? I mean, wouldn't that be like
Yeah,
everywhere he goes, where his followers are, there are these crosses, and he's like, no.
Yeah, they're saying, remember this? Remember this? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, thanks a lot, guys. I'm going to continue watching online, and I'll probably call in next week.
Okay.
All right.
Good to hear from you, Joe.
Come back and see us in Austin, Joe.
Okay.
All right. Bye-bye.
Let's go to Bob.
What?
Hello?
Bob?
Hi, Bob.
Hey, what's going on, guys? Actually, this is God.
Oh.
This is God.
This is God.
Yeah.
And peace.
A good time. I hung up on God.
All right.
Let's go to Buster.
Hey, I don't know if it's worse to hang up on Bob or fool around with Mother Nature.
What can we do for you, Buster?
Well, you need to credit Bill Hicks for that bit you were just doing. Use that for a soundbite soon, the old...
Which one?
I've already forgotten now. But
oh, hating the side of a cross?
Side of a cross, yeah. But
he was awesome, wasn't he, Bill Hicks?
Oh, yeah. Man. Oh, yeah. One thing I was curious about, this is just a general question I've always meant to throw in here. Let's say they were to prove there is a God, okay? Because we always talk about the, proof thing. Now, how, you never hear about this in religious discussions, but now, how does that have anything to do with an afterlife anyway?
Well, that's true. There could be a God, and he could be a bastard, and there could be no afterlife.
Yeah.
You know, everything could be exactly the same, except that there is some cosmic being that created everything.
There could be a God, and he could bear no resemblance whatsoever to what any of the world's religions have preached, in Christianity, Zoroastrianism, whatever.
Yeah, there does seem to be an assumption in the minds of Christians that even if they did manage to prove one part of it, which they can't, that would prove all the rest of it true,
which it wouldn't.
I've just always found that fascinating that never gets mentioned by anybody on either side.
Well, it's not a question they really like to address because they don't like to consider the possibility.
Even you guys, in the discussion, don't say, hey, let's say you did prove it. What about this?
Actually, that has come up. There's been cases where we've talked about, if there's a God, does that mean that the right thing to do is worship that being, that creature, whatever? I think we all kind of have questions about that, whether worship is ever, a real good human behavior. That makes you think of, South Sea Islanders, the first time they see people come in great big ships with cannons and everything, and they fall down and worship them because they're scared of them.
Yeah.
It just seems not like a real positive thing to do. If there's other beings out there that are maybe way powerful, that's fine, and we should be real cautious of them. But worship is kind of that it doesn't follow.
Right.
Yeah.
It also doesn't follow that because there's a being that's very powerful that they're good.
Right.
Yeah. No, that's a good point, Buster.
Well, thank you, and I'm been up all night, so I'm too tired to try to think of anything else to say.
All right.
You guys keep going.
All right.
You have a good day, man.
Thanks for the call.
Bye.
Okay. We're waiting for some more calls to get cycled through the system.
Gee, how about that meeting last Sunday?
How about that? Oh, you want to talk about that now? Okay.
All
right. So last Sunday we had our lecture series at Furs Cafeteria, and the guest was this fellow by the name of Bill Hughes, who showed up at one of our earlier lectures and identified himself as an army chaplain.
And he was invited to come in and talk about the legalities of army chaplains and about atheists and atheism in the military. Well, he showed up, and he opened his spiel by doing this short talk on the common ground that he thought that he had with atheists. And what he did when he laid this common ground is he said a bunch of philosophical nonsense that, in fact, we didn't agree with. And when he was asked direct questions about the laws behind the chaplaincy and the rights of non-Christians, he mostly dodged the questions. He mostly claimed ignorance.
Yeah, so just said.
And here's a guy who supposedly his job is to be the guy who, you know, is who should be walking that careful line between what the government can legally do and what it can't. He didn't know. And if he didn't know, and it's his job, it seems to me, he didn't care. Mm. He was there to preach Christianity to us.
That's right, yeah.
And several of the members of the group got up and left, and I thought it was entirely appropriate for them to do so.
This guy got dogpiled, folks. He got...
Yeah, the people that remained...
It was a philosophical mosh pit, okay? It got ugly, and it started ugly and got worse.
He had no idea what he was talking about. It was entirely generic Christian dogma. When he was asked hard questions, he would answer, "I don't know," and he would leap to the excuse that, well, maybe I'm not as intelligent as you.
Yeah, which was...
As if that had anything to do with it. Being dumb does not mean that the arguments you're making are smart, right? Yeah, the arguments either stand or fail on their own merits.
But moreover, that answer was just an excuse not to have to defend his position,
right?
Because
when he was presented with clear evidence that things that he had claimed were just wrong, his response was, "Well, that's just your opinion." And he did that over and over and over again. Mm. So,
yeah.
It was a travesty.
Yeah,
I would call it a travesty.
It started out... Now, I think that what he thought he was doing when he started was that he was simply explaining to all of us what his beliefs were,
yeah,
so that we could then maybe understand where he was coming from. Mm-hmm. But I think just based upon who he is, a chaplain and a minister, that explanation took the form of a sermon. You know, it's just the way he is used to addressing groups of people.
It's who he is.
From behind a podium. And so it, I'd say we were no fewer than 5 to 10 minutes into the thing. Ray Blevins was the first guy who got up and stormed out.
Yep.
And my initial reaction to that was, "Oh, no, Ray, please sit down. Don't do it." Because I was at first worried that, oh, no, this is going to reinforce the negative stereotype of atheists as being these closed-minded, angry, arrogant people who don't want to hear, you know, anything. But, you know, Ray's a friend, and I thoroughly respected his doing that, you know, exercising his choice to do that. And I have to say, as it got on and just got sillier and crazier, you know, there were many points at which I came, you know, that close to walking out myself.
Me too.
Specifically, when he began to, what's his name? The guy who...
Oh.
Paul Wilson.
Paul Wilson, who's been a guest on our show.
Yeah. Went after this fellow with both barrels, but
Paul ripped this man a new philosophical orifice.
Yeah.
Just,
imagine having
awesome to behold.
Yeah, a 20-barrel shotgun full of Dolot buck, and Paul just unloaded on him, and basically pointing out the moral quandaries that the existence of a God or the Christian God would bring about. Particularly, how do you justify the whole, for example, Paul's main example was the Nazi Holocaust. Mm-hmm. If your God exists and he is who he is, how can he sit back and blindly watch 6 million innocents led to the slaughter? And of course, the minister's first response was to bring up the whole free will doctrine, which we kind of punctured right away.
Right. Let me jump in here, because that was the point when I was actually interacting with this guy too, and I asked him, you know, do you think it's plainly obvious that the world is round? And he said yes. And I said, are you aware that there are people who still don't believe it?
Yes, there are people who
have... And he said yes. And my point is, God could clearly prove his existence to us without forcing anybody to believe in him.
Yeah.
Because there are other things that are obviously true that some people refrain from believing in
right.
anyway.
Yeah.
So that's not just a complete red herring.
Yeah.
It means nothing.
My analogy was to the presidency. Everyone knows who the president is, but that knowledge does not obligate you to vote for him or support his policies.
That's another good point.
Yeah.
Exactly right. Then he went on to say that, well, God didn't interfere with the Holocaust because mankind needed to learn a lesson.
That was the most offensive thing he said.
To which I responded, you know, apart from the Nazis themselves, who were the people on the earth who needed to learn that particular lesson, right? Didn't absolutely everybody else, and even most Nazis mm-hmm. who only went along with it because they were in the party and there was a power structure that was making them do what they did, didn't humanity already know that you don't round up huge numbers of people and gas them to death?
And shove their corpses into ovens?
That's absolutely ridiculous.
What offended me the most was that he kept referring to himself as a truth seeker.
Yeah.
You know, and but then he says, but particularly in one of his responses to the Holocaust example, was the most staggering thing I've ever heard any Christian say was that sometimes evil can be good. And then he went on with the whole explanation of how this was an important lesson that God allowed happen for the rest of us to know that genocide was a bad thing. Now,
I've heard Eddie Murphy say that in his vampire movie where he was disguised as a preacher and trying to turn the congregation evil by telling them that evil was
That's right, Vampire in Brooklyn.
That's right.
But
I've heard that.
You know, the thing is, I'm sorry. If you are a truth seeker, you do not make, if you even have the remotest concept of what the word truth means, you don't make excuses for evil. You condemn evil unequivocally in all its forms. And if you're going to call yourself a truth seeker and then say that you believe in a God, and then start making excuses for when it can be shown that this God is either A, doing evil things deliberately, or B, through omission of action, allowing evil events to occur and turning a blind eye to them, then you are not a truth seeker. You are a rube and a chump.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah, we got a bunch of calls now.
And boy, that lit up the lines, didn't we?
Let's take some.
Let's talk to Michelle.
Michelle? Michelle?
Michelle? I guess Michelle gave up on us.
Did we lose her?
I think we did. Yeah.
I think we're gone.
We have a hang up. So
Michelle,
how about Steve?
If you somehow got cut off, please call back. We get try to get you back on.
Okay.
Then let's go to Steve.
Hey, how's it going?
Hi, fine, man. How you doing? What's up?
Hey, you know how you guys were talking about the crosses?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
What was that? I like just turned on the
TV.
Well,
what do you think Jesus's reaction would be if he came back and saw all these crosses hanging around?
I don't know, but I got some pizza.
All right.
Yeah. We see the true face of Christians.
All right. Yeah. Well, I don't know who that guy was.
No.
The board says we got somebody on too, but we don't have a name.
RC.
Cola.
RC?
Hey, good
morning.
Hi,
what's up?
I wanted to make a comment about the Ten Commandments. Y'all had talked about that a little earlier.
Uh-huh.
Right.
And, I believe it's the gentleman to the right that had talked about Christians and the subject of public displays in prayer several weeks ago. And this kind of falls under the same category. I'm a Christian, and I don't think there's any need or injunction from God to be running around and putting up Ten Commandment on the walls. I think that eventually your argument and others will prevail against those who are doing it. If you read carefully your Old Testament, you'll see that the original Ten Commandments were placed inside the covenant or the Ark, and were not a subject of something that became an icon where people would, especially in the New Testament, would place in their homes or write. And you know, when you go into Christian churches today, very seldom will you see the Ten Commandments up on the wall.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
Interesting point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good point. I agree with you.
Of course, you're right that the Old Testament doesn't describe the commandments being put on the wall. They put them in the ark. They carried them around, and somehow
and if you touched them, you got fried.
Yeah. Somehow this ark was a very powerful weapon, as modern movies have testified to. But that
You know, that is part of the Old Testament literature that you couldn't touch it.
Y'all are taking a common practice by Christians that maybe get a little too aggressive in their practice, but you're probably doing some good, even to the Christians today, to rethink that whole situation, because we're taught not to make a graven image or to put something like that up and then really become enamored with the object itself. In fact, the Bible basically teaches to have these absolute moral principles hidden in our heart, and that's the important thing, not the public display. That's all I had.
Okay. Right, and also, I think, was it in the New Testament, Jesus said that the appropriate way to pray, Howard Thompson brought this up when he was on the show a couple of weeks ago, you go into your closet and it's a very private affair, and I think that the fundamentalists who want to have prayer in schools are sort of not really understanding that caring.
You're right.
They are after the reins of political power.
Yeah, it's all about power.
And, you know, we... If people want to believe their Christianity, and if they want to pray and all that stuff, that's perfectly fine. The instant you start using the power of government to impose that on people who don't agree with those beliefs, you've crossed a line.
Yeah. What the fundamentalists who are trying to pass this legislation don't understand is that a separation of church and state protects them.
Exactly.
America is a secular nation. Okay, they constantly harp on it's a Christian nation founded on Christian values. It is a secular nation.
Exactly.
Okay, and it is only in a secular nation that you can have the religious freedoms that they cherish. Okay, if you are living in a secular nation and 95 or 90% of the population decides that it wants to believe in a God of some sort, you are free to do that in a secular nation. But if you are in a religiously governed nation and 10% of the population decide we don't want to believe in God, well, you can believe that we would be in some trouble. You know, so it is, you know, it's about protecting them. And some people might say, well, what's wrong with having the Ten Commandments up in school? Well, the first four of them are direct instructions to believe in and worship the Christian God. And it is not the government's place to tell citizens to do that.
I think
it primarily pertains to the Jewish God, but you know, Christians follow both covenants. But also wanted to apologize for the behavior of the gentleman that you're talking about that came last week. It sounds to me like he was one of those aggressive that wouldn't stay with the subject.
Here's the thing. He wasn't a bad guy. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was a very nice guy, and I think he was earnest and sincere. The problem was that we were communicating from entirely different paradigms. Mm-hmm. Okay, and he came on and he asserted things that he felt to be true, things that he felt to be just axioms by which you live your life, that we just didn't at their root accept. And he was and some people, and this got on the atheist list a little bit too, some people felt that a lot of the rebuttals that were given, like by Paul and some others, may have been a bit too aggressive, and I can see where that would come from. But a lot of it is, you know, I mean, atheists are impassioned about their viewpoints. And if you confront an atheist with something like, with a statement like, truth is subjective, or sometimes evil can be good, we're going to rebut that, and we're probably going to rebut that passionately. And that passion comes from not close-minded unwillingness to hear the Christian view, but from, you know, a general conviction that, no, those ideas are wrong. Right. They're immoral and they're unhealthy.
Also, we wanted to talk about the idea of chaplains.
Yeah,
and
that is also...
He was repeatedly reminded that that was the subject he had been invited to speak on.
Exactly. He didn't stay on topic. But anyway, just want to let y'all know, we don't always disagree on everything.
Sure.
Well, we know that.
We don't have anything against Christians. We are interested in... There seems to be a big lack of understanding in the general public about what atheists are all about. We want to address that. And there are particular groups of Christians that are doing things that we think are violations of the Constitution, or just rude, or just silly, or just, you know, violations of the own rules they claim to live by.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's why you folks are very helpful.
Okay.
Well, thanks for your call. Well, we appreciate your call, and call back sometime.
Okay.
Nice. I want to. Yeah. Yeah. We love getting nice Christian callers.
Yeah.
I want to add one more thing about on the subject of fundamentalists and their yen for political power. These are the same guys who get together in their local communities and say, well, you know, we all voted in prayer at our football games, and the you know, we shouldn't listen to the Constitution or the Supreme Court when they tell us that we are wrong, because, well, you know, we decided this, and this is supposed to be a democracy, so we get to have our way. More importantly, they start branding the Supreme Court and the Constitution evil, and I've seen them make these claims, because those things happen to stand in their way. At the point when you have citizens of a country saying that the Constitution of your country is wrong and evil, or that the highest legal power in your country is wrong and evil, and they want to overthrow that, we have a word for that. It's called treason.
But okay. Moreover, it's, you know, I've heard some Christians say things like, for example, the football game situation. You know, just like, if you're offended by the prayer, well, go out and get a hot dog. I'm sorry, that's not what America's founded on. If you don't like it, go get a hot dog. Okay? The Constitution...
No, not when you have a legal right to complain about them doing it in the
first Constitution
place.
Is in right. place to protect minorities, the interests and the concerns of minorities.
This is a democracy.
It's not just about pandering to whatever the majority view happens to be
there
at the time.
There is a difference between democracy and mob rule.
Yeah.
What they are after is mob rule.
Yeah.
Let's go to Vince.
And see what he has to say about this.
Vince?
Hey, how you guys doing?
Just fine. How are you, Vince?
I'm doing pretty good. Hey, I just was flipping through here and I saw this and I wanted to ask you a couple of questions, if you don't mind.
Sure, go ahead.
That's why we're here.
Number one, I guess the thing that intrigues me the most is when you say yourself, call yourself atheist, is it, do you not believe in any kind of higher power, or is human existence the highest existence in the universe?
Well, I can easily imagine, say, an alien race that evolved on another planet that is physically stronger than me, intellectually more intelligent than me, more educated than me, better behaved than me. I can easily imagine that. So if you want to call that a higher power, sure, I'm willing to entertain the idea that there could be higher powers. But it's at the point at which you're talking about something supernatural.
Yeah, something in a spiritual realm, not so much physical, but something transcending the physical realm.
You will pretty much find that atheists are materialists.
Yeah. Okay.
And the only reason for that is that we take the view that there has, to date, not been anything in the way of credible evidence to back up the claims that there is some sort of spirit realm or otherworldly supernatural realm in which beings like gods and angels exist. If such evidence were to present itself, we'd be happy to look at it, but we haven't seen it.
Okay, let me ask you this. Have you guys ever explored magic, like, you know, serious magic, not, hey, watch me pull a rabbit out of a hat, or...
I was enamored of that subject back in, like, high school, and read a couple of books. There was a book by P.E.I. Bonewits called Real Magic.
Yeah.
But... You know, after dabbling with it and finding that pretty much nothing happened, I gave it up.
Okay.
So have you had magic experiences you'd like to tell us about?
I have experiences. I don't want to tell you about them, though.
That's fine.
All right. It's up to you.
I was just curious if you believe in a higher power or... Well, let me ask you this one. Let me ask you another question.
Okay.
Do you mind or what?
Go ahead.
How do you explain the... Let's say in physics, we're talking about a connectedness of all things. How do you explain that connectedness? And the question that runs along with that question would be, what would be the source? I mean, looking at it from the atheistic point of view, what would be the source of life force on this planet? The source of life force. The source of life, period.
When you say life force, we're not aware of anything that really exists that could be called a life force.
Okay.
Life is biological, it's chemical, it's physical.
Okay.
You interfere with the mechanical, physical processes of a living thing, it stops doing the behaviors we call living.
And it dies.
Okay.
So so we are not aware of the existence of such a thing, and so when you ask us to explain it, we're going to shrug and go, explain what?
The best explanation that we would support would be that life has emerged on this planet as a result of natural laws working in concert with matter.
Okay.
And that this planet... And keep in mind that it was thought that, many, many years ago, microbial life may have developed on Mars as well as on the Earth, but then as Mars cooled and the climate got to a certain point where the atmosphere was too thin and the temperature was simply too cold for that life to develop beyond its microbial stage. Now, that hasn't been proved.
But we don't even have to get into that.
But the whole idea is that, life is a biological process, and we're here because conditions on our planet allow us to be here.
Yeah, it comes from natural physical processes, as far as we can tell. That's where the evidence is. Where we're going.
And if you try to find the answers to these questions, you mentioned physics.
Sure.
If you're studying physics and particles and what's happening and trying to figure out exactly what the facts are, you have to assume that there's no God involved. I mean, in order to look for the truth, you have to take that as far as you can.
Well, that's not necessarily true. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Go ahead.
Well, you can either assume that there is, and, you know, God is sort of a word tied into the whole Christianity thing, and so, but you can either assume that there is.
But if you were looking for the truth, why would you do that?
Well, let me clarify that. The problem with sort of gathering evidence from physics and other scientific disciplines with the preconception in your head that you're going to work from the basis that perhaps there is a God.
There's a higher force, yes.
Yeah. Well, let's call it God for the sake of argument.
Okay, let's call it God.
The problem that people have run into is that quite often they end up in sort of a loop in which what they are doing is they are really only looking for evidence, or they're accepting what they consider to be evidence that will support that preconception, and if other evidence tends to come into being that might differ from that, they tend to not want to look at that
but
or ignore
that,
it.
And that's true of all people. It's not just true of...
But it's better if
you do that because you had some hard evidence of your original assumptions. That's not as bad if you're biased by some previous hard evidence you had than it is if you're biased by wild assumptions that you made that you never had any evidence for. But let me try to get back to specifically to your question. You asked how do we explain the interconnectedness in physics, and I'm going to assume that I know what you mean by that. There's things like...
It all falls under vibrational theory and light science and stuff like that. It's kind of Eastern, too, Eastern mystical stuff.
Okay. I am not aware that of any hard evidence that Eastern mysticism knows what it's talking about when it comes to physics. But there are things going on that are odd, that are mysterious, and you could well ask me about any of those things. Well, how do I explain that? And my answer is, I do not explain things that I don't have an answer to.
Okay.
Right? And I don't think anybody should. The problem comes in when people concoct explanations for things when they really don't know what the answer is.
They're merely
concocting explanation to fill in that blank.
That's true, but you have to take this one thing into consideration when you do say that, though.
Huh?
You have to take one point into consideration when you do say that, why people concoct these ideas.
Okay.
Part of that is because deep within the inner psyche, the psychological effect of life, pure and simple on this earth, the whole experience that we call life, people are looking for a purpose. This purpose makes them happier.
Oh, sure. Yeah, we'll accept that.
The faith involved in the connection with a higher power, it's very much attuned to security of yourself. Hey, I belong to this.
I'll agree 100% with you
atheist.
On that.
I am an atheist, okay? I mean, I'm not, but I'm saying, I'm using that as an analogy. Okay, well, this gives you a sense of security. I am an atheist, therefore you belong to a group, you are part of something bigger than yourself.
Well, so I think that let me respond to that.
Okay.
Okay. We happen to have a group, but I was an atheist before there was a group.
Okay.
Okay. Atheist means to me not that I am a member of an organization, Atheist means to me, I'm a guy that doesn't happen to believe in any gods.
Okay.
Okay.
I don't have a problem
sure,
with that,
we
really.
Sure, we completely recognize that being, having people who agree on certain things together
uh-huh.
is a positive, enjoyable experience.
Uh-huh.
We recognize that, but that's not why we're atheists. We actually have the group because we recognize
we
that
wanted
we don't
to meet
have
other atheists.
The imaginary, made-up comfort that that people who believe in various supernatural thingies do, right?
Okay, well,
and
me,
so we're making an effort to get together and like socialize because it is a good thing for us.
Okay, let me purport this question to you for just a moment, all right?
Yeah, sure.
What if that person has had experiences?
Which person?
Well, I'm saying we're making an analogy of hey, I believe this or I believe that, and you were just saying, well, you know, made up,
yeah.
blah, 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 in reference to something
yeah.
supernatural,
okay.
something higher outside of themselves.
Good point.
Suppose, what if that,
so you're asking me, what if, like, some guy has actually had a real supernatural experience?
Well, let's not just say some guy. What if a multiplicity of persons
yeah.
has had experiences that are phenomenal. They go beyond the realm of, hey, this is the physical explanation
okay.
of what happened
until,
here and blah, blah,
until
blah.
They can repeat those experiences, until they can make it happen again,
uh-huh.
until
there's some sort of independent
document its occurrence to the point where they can convince skeptical people.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't, there is no, until that point, there is no evidence of its existence outside of their heads.
And it's also well understood that cultural influences play a part in that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And you see that
Buddhist,
in things like,
Yeah,
well, for example, you see things in that like UFO. Right. People believe in UFO abductions.
Oh, sure, so,
yeah.
of course.
Yeah.
The thing is, anything that it doesn't matter how many people, right? I mean, at some point in our history, most people on the Earth believed that, say, the Sun orbited the Earth.
Of course.
That's what it seemed like.
Of course.
It wasn't
Copernicus
true.
Came along, yeah.
It doesn't matter if you've got a whole bunch of people saying they think a certain thing is true.
Right.
It's either true or it isn't, independent of what they think about it, and therefore you prove things on the basis of looking at the evidence. You don't prove things on the basis of, well, hold up your hands, all you people who believe in magic.
Okay.
There's just no, I mean, if somebody who believes in magic can go into a controlled situation and
uh-huh.
prove that they can really do something,
yes.
that's evidence for something. But
okay.
just getting together with a bunch of your friends and saying, we all believe this way,
well, yeah, no,
absolutely nothing.
I thoroughly agree with what you say.
Okay.
Especially in regards to that. You need hard evidence.
Yeah.
You also need experiential knowledge, I think, to truly foundate your idea of, hey, I believe this or I believe that. But what I...
How's that? I don't have personal experience of, you know, standing on the moon, but there's plenty of evidence that we sent some guys up there and they tromped around in spacesuits.
Well, because you experienced it through television. Right? Is that
yeah, you want to be a little careful about just assuming that it's because it was on TV, because, you
well,
know, I can watch Buffy the Vampire Slayer and see magic on TV.
These are newsreels that you believe, therefore you experienced it from the television. I mean, you know, but aside from that point.
I don't believe it because I saw it on television. I believe it because I understand what science is. I understand the physics involved in, you know, how you'd get a guy up there in a general sense.
Well, sure,
right?
Yeah.
I understand that the science on which the Apollo project was based can be demonstrated to the general public and has been on numerous occasions.
Okay, one more question.
Okay.
Well, possibly one more question anyway. I mean, am I taking up too much of your time?
Go right ahead.
Go for one more,
yeah.
and then we'll...
Okay, one more again. We do have a couple more people to take after you, so we'll do one more.
Okay, as for the idea of faith...
Yeah.
Okay, faith is a very, very, very strong force in the human psyche.
What do you mean by faith? Because
faith,
there are a bunch of definitions.
Faith can translate anything from religion to belief in yourself.
Okay,
I mean,
and
faith,
how do you mean it?
Faith on the broad bend. What I'm describing faith,
okay.
I'm saying a very firm, solid belief.
Yeah. Can be very
in
powerful, okay? We agree.
Something higher and something more powerful
more what? More enlarged.
Okay.
Itself.
All right. And you're saying, what do we think of that?
No, I'm not saying what you think of it. I'm going to pose this statement to you, and then I'm going to hang up and let you answer it.
All right. Great.
This faith has inevitably changed a lot of people's lives. It makes their lives better. It makes their lives more enjoyable. It makes their lives more secure.
Yeah.
It makes their lives more more tangible, I would say. That's not a bad word.
More
I think
tangible?
It makes their lives, huh?
Go on.
I know what he means.
Okay, so basically, as an atheist, are you thinking that all of this is a bad thing, or are you thinking that all of this is just okay?
Okay.
And are you trying?
We'll
to,
answer that.
Are you trying? Wait, let me finish.
Okay.
And then I'm going to hang up. I won't take up any more of your time. Are you trying to convince people that, hey, faith in something else is just this big farce, and that you know, blah blah blah, or are you saying, hey, you believe what you want, but we have to have hardcore evidence before we can put our faith in something that we cannot see?
Okay.
And that's about it. And then explain to me a little bit about what an atheist actually is, okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Our pleasure. And thanks for calling.
Bye-bye.
Let's start with what an atheist is. An atheist is a guy who doesn't believe in any gods. Okay, we're done with that.
The problem of faith.
What I think... Okay, first of all, there are multiple definitions of atheism. Let's stick to the one that he was talking about, which is strong belief in stuff. And specifically, you know, that kind of strong belief in stuff, in various things that can psychologically affect you. Okay, we would point out that that kind of strong belief in various things that affect people psychologically also does bad things.
Yes,
it sure
right?
does.
Bunches of people died in the Middle Ages in the Crusades because some people had really strong faith.
Yeah.
In fact, we had two different sides in that conflict that both had very strong faith. Okay, and they killed a lot of each other.
Or even today, there's a branch of religion called the Christian Science. And they don't believe in medicine or hospitals or doctors. And the whole idea, if you're a Christian Scientist, is that you lock yourself in a room and you pray and you pray and you pray until you get better, unless you unfortunately happen to die in the midst of the praying, which would be inconvenient. But you know, that's what happened to Jim Henson. And there have actually been parents who have been charged with negligent homicide and sent to jail because they refused to take their very ill child to a doctor to get treated. And the child died for lack of medical treatment because the parents were in the other room praying and exercising their faith, you know, and praying to God to make their child well.
Okay, so
faith is not always a good thing.
So faith, see, I would look at the whole faith thing and say, well, what is it then? Well, it's neither all good nor all bad. It is specifically strong belief in stuff, and in the particular cases that the caller was asking about, it's strong belief in stuff that can have then a further psychological effect on you. People ought to know it for what it is. Strong belief in a certain premise does not make the premise true. Mm-hmm. Okay? I recognize that you can, if you are unhappy, you can get more happy by believing things that you can't prove are true, even by believing in things that happen not to be true.
Sure.
The problem comes in where once you've gone ahead and believed in things that turn out not to be true in order to get your jollies, then you're now a person who is happy but believes some things that aren't true, and you have a completely different problem. So that's my take on it. You guys,
you're exactly right. There's lots of warm, fuzzy, touchy-feely stuff that you can get from participating in this kind of stuff. And that is frankly, you know, the fact that something is true is more important than how good it feels.
And the thing about faith is, it's okay, as Jeff said, you know, if to have it as something of a security blanket. And there's nothing wrong, for example, with saying that, you know, I have faith in my spouse or my friends or my ability to do my
faith. There are wide range of definitions.
But the problem is that when you start applying faith to supernatural topics and then you try to raise it to the level of an epistemological tool, then you run into serious problems, because what you are then trying to do is bring faith into the realm of reason. and have it apply and have the same rules apply to it. And the problem is faith can't stand up to those tests.
That's right. It is not a way to find out if something is true, and it is not on the same level of using reason, evidence.
To address a further question that the caller might have asked if he was still on the line, the way that I try to be happy in my life while I go around trying not to believe stuff that I have no good reason to believe is true, is I try to get however much happiness I can honestly earn within the bounds of the things that, as far as I can tell, they're actually true.
Yeah.
That means I'm going to have to face some hard realities that that do not make me happy. I don't brush them aside. Yeah. I don't turn a blind eye to them. I accept those for what they are, while simultaneously working to earn the right to have real happiness based on real things.
Yeah, I mean, to me, knowledge, learning things, learning about the world is what makes me happy.
I want to remind everyone that the Atheist Community of Austin meets at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop at 10:30 right after the show. That's near the corner of 5th and...
Lavaca.
Lavaca. Yeah. And let's take some more calls.
Florence.
Let's go to... Florence?
Hi.
Hello, Florence. Florence.
Morning, Florence.
What can we do for you?
I'm so glad I finally got in.
We've been having some long calls today.
Right. And you're Jeff, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And you and the other young man used to be on with the bald head. I know y'all really, and this other gentleman over here, I'm used to y'all. But anyway, my thing is, And don't y'all put the spooky music on me, because I'm not like that.
Well, Allah's not here today doing the sounds, so
okay. We don't have spooky music.
Okay, I do see visions.
Uh-huh.
And I don't understand where or why I do see them. Now, I could not tell you what's going to happen to me tomorrow, or you or anybody else. The visions come to me and they leave me. I don't know why this happened, but it does happen to me. So I do believe in it, because I've seen evidence of my visions coming true. I give you an example. The young man from Mexico that was doing all of this raping and stuff, and killing people.
I didn't read about that or hear about that.
Well, that was a while back.
Oh, that guy.
Oh, him. Okay.
Okay. Well, I seen visions of him. Never met him in my life, but I saw that in the crime. I also do not believe in the Bible, but I get scorned because people tell me, how can you believe in a vision, something there's no proof of, but you cannot believe in the Bible, and it's written down in black and white.
Right.
And I'm telling them, what's written in black and white, to me, I have so many questions about. And having the questions and no answers, I cannot believe in it. So it's hard for people to understand me. So I do feel like I'm on the outside looking in a lot of situations, you know, especially with this. Yeah. And I really wanted y'all to ask y'all about that vision thing. Where do this come from, if y'all do know, and I just tuned
when
in.
When do you have these visions, ma'am?
Excuse me?
Are they dreams?
When
are
do
they
you,
waking
when,
dreams?
You know, it started out when it was in dreams, but now I have them woken. I can just, like now, close my eyes. Like now, and I see nothing but blackness. My eyes are closed. I see nothing.
Mm-hmm.
I can close my eyes sometime, and I can go to another place, somebody else's house. Uh-huh. And I can see something happening there, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know why it happened.
Okay.
I just know that it does.
You're asking atheists, okay? You're asking this question of atheists.
Yes.
And we do not believe, because we don't have any evidence.
That's right.
That there's anything supernatural going on anywhere, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You could be the first. You could perform some scientific tests or submit yourself for scientific testing, and you could be the first to demonstrate clearly under laboratory conditions that your visions really are you seeing stuff that's going on somewhere else with some kind of supernatural sense.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you could be.
Mm-hmm.
I doubt it.
Mm-hmm. But claims of this sort have been made throughout history, and you know, my own grandmother used to tell me about how when my mother was a teenager, they had a house out in East Texas, and that house burned down, and my grandmother told me that before it happened, she had a vision of smoke swirling around a ceiling of they were somewhere else, and then they found out later that the house burned down and what have you.
Yeah.
You know, now
Those are psychological phenomena that are still being studied. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't have any definite answers for you on them. I don't believe, I'm not of the opinion that they are necessarily supernatural in nature, or even that they are tied into the thing that the person who then later on goes to experience an event that reminds them of the vision are in fact tied into those events. You know, there is a lot of study to be done there. But
let me tell you something about what the evidence is. Okay. About those kinds of things, okay? There are people who have visions, and they can be described medicines, and they stop having visions. Mm-hmm. Yeah. This tells me it's chemical, it's biological, yeah. It's not supernatural. Mm-hmm. There is a group of psychological phenomenon that closely match reports of like UFO abductions and encounters with ghosts, okay? Feeling the presence of mysterious beings near you, having a sense of leaving your body, and things like that. Mm-hmm. There's a scientist in Canada who can put a helmet on your head with electrodes that touch your skull and induce those sensations by electrically stimulating parts of your brain. Mm. Okay. Again, this is evidence that what's going on is
brain chemistry,
entirely physical brain chemistry happening inside your head.
Okay, but
what we don't have are really clear examples of anybody who can sit down, have a vision, predict a specific thing that's going to happen, and then people go to wherever that's going to happen at the time when it's supposed to happen and see it
happen.
And
it happens.
Okay, it's always after the fact. You know, or it's always people who, after something has happened, they say they remember. Oh well, I had a vision that was sort of like that. I bet I
well,
envisioned
see,
that.
Well, mine's different, and I have witnesses. I tell people of my visions when I do see them. Uh-huh. So there are people that can verify. Ever since, well, at least going back 20 years. But as I said, I couldn't tell you for what's happening tomorrow. It's just something that does come to me. It's something I have no control of. It's not chemical produced.
Yeah. We weren't implying anything. But when you say those people can verify,
it's because I told them.
Right. So the only
body, the police be investigating a crime, and I tell them they brought in psychics. And I tell them, no, the police is saying the body been moved way out. I said, no, that body is over there in those projects. It's what's happened, you know, and where it happened. But I wake up and I tell them, or I tell them while we sitting up eating, and I say, oh, my God, somebody's in trouble, you know.
Yeah, the problem is that it's really very, very easy for people who have these kinds of experiences to go back and retrofit.
Yeah.
What they thought they saw. You know, I dream a dream where I'm riding in a car and I look out the window and I see a water tower. Right? Now there's a memory in my head of being in a car, mm-hmm. or of dreaming being in a car and seeing a water tower. Mm-hmm. Then I drive all around and eventually I'm going to see a water tower. And that may trigger a memory of that dream. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that the water tower that I just saw was the water tower that I dreamed, and it doesn't mean that there was anything significant about that, okay? To prove that your visions really are valid, you've got to be very precise. I mean, we're talking
and
about
I
supernatural
am.
Power here.
I am.
There's no excuse for any kind of inaccuracy, mm-hmm. in predictions that are supernatural. Mm-hmm. If they're not bounded by the laws of physics and the limits of our normal senses, then there's no excuse to have anything less than absolutely precise visions of, mm-hmm. specific things happening with precise details. Complete details.
And if you think you
can do that, get thee to a laboratory and prove it. There is a guy, James Randi,
yes.
who is a stage magician, who is offering $1 million to anybody who can prove that ability to him under laboratory conditions. That guy's got a webpage. Go look him up. If you can do it, go win your $1 million and prove it to everybody. I'd really love to know if there were abilities like that that really, really were true.
It would
be important information for me to have, but I'm not going to believe it until it's proved.
And this is
the kind of thing that should be very easy to demonstrate. It should be very easy to prove. A junior high student could design experiments that that should be able to prove if this has any validity or not.
Okay. Let me say one more thing before you hang up.
All right.
Okay. Another thing I wanted to say is that I don't understand why blacks and Indians believe in Christianity, for the simple reason we knew nothing about Christianity until we came here or it was brought to us. We had another belief system, and that is another reason why I do not believe, you know, in the Bible. And I'm not putting nobody down.
Right. Well, that's probably the result of, you know, the pressure of the culture that you're in, and it's also the result of just the aggressiveness of Christian missionaries who like to get out there and strong arm anyone they can into following that. It all ties into this legislation that I reported on in the news at the beginning of the show about now they want to get the religious documents mounted in public buildings. It's a very aggressive conversion effort, and when you couple that with the amazing appeal to both authoritarianism and emotionalism that Christianity just seems to have a great lock on, it's very difficult for a lot of people to resist that. So,
Okay, Jeff, give me the guy's name again. Not that I want the million, but I do want to understand what's happening and why it's happening.
James,
because I'm that kind of person, I question everything.
Okay. The name is James. Randy.
Okay.
The last name is spelled R-A-N-D-I.
Okay.
And he's written some books. You can go and look up his books, too.
Okay. Thank you. Right. Y'all have a good one. Bye-bye.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right.
There is a phenomenon that is called shared psychotic disorder. Mm-hmm. And this actually shows how things like this can happen not only to one person, but then it can spread throughout a culture. Let's say I have a dog, and I think that my dog talks to me. Okay. And I start telling you about it. You know, my dog, and he talks, and then, you know, and you're like, man, you're out of your mind. But then, after a while, for some reason, you suddenly start thinking, did that dog talk? I think that dog can talk. And then it can go on, and it becomes what it is. It's sort of a feedback loop.
Right.
And this is a known and well understood psychological phenomenon in which you first have a person who has a delusion, and I'm not saying that woman's crazy or delusional or anything like that, but usually in these cases you have a person who has a delusion, and that delusion can be spread. And that is what we see, for example, in cases like ghost stories and haunted houses, and particularly UFO abductions.
Yeah.
You know, it's culture.
People are imaginative.
And
suggestible.
Yeah, and suggestible, highly
exactly.
suggestible. Well, maybe we got...
At least that is the explanation that fits the evidence that is available.
Okay.
So let's go to...
Arturo?
How's your name, sir?
Arturo.
Arturo.
What can we do for you, Arturo?
I'm finally glad I kind of was able to get on.
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, no problem.
We're coming down to the wire here. What can we do for you?
Okay, well, I just wanted to air a few opinions.
Okay.
Basically, my first one is, well, who's to say that God doesn't work within the boundaries of science?
Okay, because there are quite a number of claims, because there are claims of miracles.
Okay, well, but who's to say that miracles cannot be explained scientifically?
Here's the point, okay? There are guys who are trying to claim now that, like, quantum indeterminacy is a loophole that God could use to make stuff happen, right?
Okay.
That is a popular theory with religious scientists these days. The problem is that the vast majority of scientific studies are evaluated statistically, and any tinkering by a god in what would otherwise be random quantum probability would show up, right? There would be clear statistical evidence that something unusual had happened, and we never see that. Never. That's the problem.
Okay. They've taken the Hubble telescope.
Uh-huh.
Okay. They say that when they go out to a certain distance, that the actual laws of physics break down.
Who says this?
Okay, I forget who it is. I was looking something on, you know, the Discovery Channel and all that bull. Here's another thing, though.
Okay.
All right.
Okay,
This is just basically, you know, my own little opinions and stuff like that.
Okay.
If you take science, okay, and you say that, you know, you use, it's basically you're using the opposite. Okay, if you're going through science without without any kind of comprehension of any kind of God, it would be the same as some type of fundamentalist.
Okay,
taking this, you know, taking
it's
the side
not,
that there is a
and
God.
Let me explain why it's not. Okay, say I have two liquid chemicals,
okay, and I have 100 beakers full of each, and I take a beaker of one chemical and a beaker of another chemical, and I mix it together, and the resulting mixture turns blue. And I do that 100 times, and 99 times out of 100 it turns blue. One time it didn't. Okay. Now, if I'm just doing science, and I'm not assuming that any supernatural forces exist, I can conclude, oops, when you mix those things together, it's going to turn blue, because physics is going to work that way. If I believe that there is a supernatural entity who can tinker with the results, I can't draw any conclusions, because I don't know if the results I got are a demonstration of the natural laws of the universe, or whether they are the result of some unfathomable expression of God's will.
Okay.
You got to exclude the premise that there's a God tinkering with things, or you can't do science.
You can't draw any conclusions.
The only thing you could do if you want to assume there's a God is turn to your religious leaders and ask them, what's God up to turning these liquids blue? All right? Thanks, everybody.
Seconds.
Thanks for watching.
Bye, we're off the air.
We'll see you next week.